Good afternoon. I welcome all the the media persons and my colleagues from the Reserve Bank to the last monetary policy of the current financial year, and what also happens to be the first monetary policy committee press conference of the new calendar year. So there is an element of consistency between the last meeting in December and this meeting in January, in terms of the fact that we have kept the rates unchanged and the stance also unchanged. So there is continuity, but it should not be read as a pointer for the future action of the Monetary Policy Committee. The Monetary Policy Committee will be guided by the evolving situation and take whatever steps are required at the appropriate time in the most opportune manner to optimize the impact of various monetary policy actions. So with these words, I would first like to make the statement. Thereafter, my colleagues and I, we will answer your questions. Over the last 3 days, that is during 4th, 5th and 6th February, the Monetary Policy Committee met and assessed the current and evolving macroeconomic financial conditions and the outlook. After extensive and drill-down review and discussions, the MPC voted unanimously to keep the policy rate unchanged. It also decided to continue with the accommodative stance as long as necessary to revive growth while ensuring that inflation remains within the target. While this decision may be on expected lines and perhaps widely discounted, it is important not to discount the Reserve Bank of India. It has to be kept in mind that the central bank has several instruments at its command that it can deploy to address the challenges that the Indian economy currently faces in terms of the sluggishness in the growth momentum. Consequently, even though the present monetary policy decision is constrained by elevated inflation pressures, there are other ways in which the RBI can strive to revive growth. I know I have whetted your curiosity, but first let me briefly explain the main considerations underlying the MPC's decision. At this stage, I would like to express my gratitude to the MPC members for their insights and careful evaluation which shaped the policy decision. The MPC's resolution has just been released on the RBI website. I also want to thank our teams in the Reserve Bank for their continued high-quality support to the MPC's work through their hard work, research, and logistics. The MPC noted that since its meeting in early December 2019, global economic activity has remained subdued. However, some variations in macroeconomic performance are becoming evident among major economies. In the United States, pace of growth has been broadly maintained in the second half of 2019. But in the euro area, the United Kingdom, and in Japan, economic activity has slowed down in Q4. Among emerging market economies, the Chinese economy decelerated to a 29-year low in 2019, while a loss of momentum was manifest in Russia, Brazil, and South Africa. Crude oil prices have softened from mid-January with a sharp fall towards the end of the month, triggered by the outbreak of the coronavirus. With international food prices rising on higher demand and supply disruptions, inflation has edged up in some major advanced economies and EMEs. Global financial markets remained resilient in December 2019 and January 2020 as thawing in US-China trade relations and improved prospects of an orderly orderly Brexit buoyed investors' sentiments. Turning to the Indian economy, the first advanced estimates released by the National Statistical Office on January 7th placed India's real GDP growth for 1920 at 5%. In terms of high-frequency indicators, both production and imports of capital goods, which are two key pointers of investment activity, continued to contract in November and December. Government expenditure, especially that of the central government, is, however, providing counter-cyclical support to the domestic demand. On the supply side, Rabi sowing has been higher by 9.5% up to January 31st, 2020, compared with a year ago. And horticulture production is estimated to have risen by 0.8% to a record level in 1920. Industrial activity improved in November after contracting in the previous 3 months. The output of core industries returned to positive territory in December after 4 months of contraction, which augurs well for the December 2019 industrial production print. Capacity utilization in the manufacturing sector, however, fell in Q2 of 1920, even on a seasonally adjusted basis. Manufacturing sector faced weak demand conditions in Q3 1920, though business sentiment is improving. This is corroborated in the Manufacturing Purchasing Managers Index, PMI, which picked up sharply in January 2020 on the back of increased output and new orders. In the services sector, several high-frequency indicators have turned upwards in the recent period, such as tractor sales, which represents rural demand, domestic air passenger traffic, an indicator of urban demand, three-wheeler sales, railway freight, and port traffic. The PMI services index also improved sharply in January, boosted by a rise in new businesses and output. On the other hand, passenger vehicle sales contracted in December. Retail inflation measured by CPI surged to 7.4% in December, the highest reading since July 2014. Food inflation rose to double digits, primarily caused by a spike in onion prices due to unseasonal rains in October-November. Excluding onions, in fact, the headline inflation would have been 5.2%. Prices of several other food subgroups such as milk, pulses, cereals, edible oil, egg, meat, fish also firmed up. Fuel prices moved out of deflation. Inflation in CPI, excluding food and fuel, that is core inflation, continued to edge up from its October trough. In the external sector, merchandise exports continued to contract in November and December, reflecting the slowdown in global trade. Import growth slumped further in November-December, reflecting the underlying weaknesses in domestic demand. Net foreign direct investment, however, rose to $24.4 billion in April to November 2019 from $21.2 billion a year ago. Net foreign portfolio investment was of the order of $8.6 billion in 1920 up to February 4th, as against net outflows of $14.2 billion in the same period last year. In addition, net investment by FPIs under the voluntary retention route have aggregated US$7.8 billion since March 11, 2019. External commercial borrowings were higher at $13.4 billion during April-December, as compared with $2.5 billion during the same period a year ago. India's foreign exchange reserves were at $471.4 billion on February 4, 2020, an increase of $58.5 billion over end March 2019. Taking into consideration these factors, the MPC revised the CPI inflation projection upwards to 6.5% in Q4 of 1920, 5.4 to 5% in H1 of 2020, and 3.2% in Q3 2021, with risks broadly balanced. It also projected GDP growth for 2021 at 6%, in the range of 5.5 to 6% in H1 and 6.2% in Q3. While doing so, the MPC noted that inflation has surged above the upper tolerance band around the target in December 2019. Over the coming weeks and months, onion prices are likely to ebb as supply conditions improve, but this could be tempered by hardening of prices of other food items, notably those of pulses, proteins, and adjustments to telecom charges. Accordingly, the MPC will remain vigilant about the potential generalization of inflationary pressures. At the same time, the economy remains weak and the output gap is negative. Financial flows to the commercial sector have, however, improved in recent months. The Union Budget 2021 has introduced several measures to provide an impetus to growth, including the emphasis on boosting the rural economy and infrastructure, income tax rate adjustments, GST reductions, and corporate tax cuts in September 2019. Given the evolving growth inflation dynamics, the MPC felt it appropriate to maintain status quo on the policy repo rate, but resolved to continue with the accommodative stance as long as necessary to revive growth while ensuring that inflation remains within the target. The MPC also recognized that there is monetary policy space for future action. I want to use the backdrop of the MPC's deliberations to explain how the RBI envisages the impact of monetary policy decision on reviving growth while ensuring price stability. First, it's necessary to recognize that the transmission of monetary policy rate reductions has been sizable across various money and bond market segments. As against the cumulative reduction in policy repo rate by 135 basis points since February last year, transmission to various money and corporate debt segments ranged from 146 basis points in the case of overnight call money market to 190 basis points in the case of three-month CPs of non-banking finance companies. Transmission through longer end of government securities market was at 73 bips with regard to five-year government securities and 76 basis points with regard to 10-year government securities. Moreover, transmission to credit market is also gradually improving. The one-year median marginal cost of funds-based lending rate, that is MCLR, has declined by 55 basis points between February 19 and January 20. The weighted average lending rate, WLR, on fresh rupee loans sanctioned by banks has declined by 69 basis points. If you recall, in the last MPC, I had stated this figure to be 49 basis points. Now it stands at 69 basis points. And WALR on outstanding rupee loans has also gone down by 13 basis points during February-December. The external benchmark system introduced from 1st October 19 has strengthened monetary transmission further. Most banks have linked their lending rates for housing, personal and micro small enterprises and to the policy rate of the Reserve Bank. During October-December, the WLR of domestic banks, both public and private sector put together on fresh rupee loans, declined by 18 basis points for housing loans, 87 basis points for vehicle loans, and 23 basis points for loans to MSMEs. These developments should amplify the effects of cumulative policy rate reductions since February 2019 and help boost domestic demand going forward. Underlying the decline in GDP growth in 19-20 is a deceleration in private consumption, stagnation in investment, and contraction in both exports and imports under the impact of slowdown in global growth and trade. Looking ahead, the pickup in GDP growth in 2021 is likely to be led by private consumption, which should benefit from higher spending power on account of the reduction in GST rates and income tax rate reductions for middle-income slabs. Rural incomes would be supported by expected bumper Rabi production and recent improvement in terms of trade for the farm sector on account of higher food prices. The outlook for investment is also showing signs of improvement. The corporate tax regime brought in from September 2019 should improve the competitiveness of Indian businesses. There is some evidence from unaudited balance sheets of listed firms that the corporate tax cut has bolstered their retained earnings, which in turn is being plowed back into creation of fixed assets rather than into financial savings or cash holdings. Furthermore, the Union Budget envisages that capital outlay, excluding defense, would expand by 26.2%, which could crowd in private investment. Overall, gross fixed investment could rise and propel domestic demand, income, and employment. Sectors that could benefit from Union Budget's capex commitments are power, cement, aviation, transport, and roads. The RBI will continue to be watchful of how these growth potentials actually play out. Turning to inflation, the main driver of the recent surge has been onion and other vegetable prices, as already stated earlier. Softening of onion prices has already, however, commenced with arrival of the late Kharif crop. As regards prices of other vegetables, the usual winter softening has been delayed, but potato prices have started to ease and prices of other vegetables may soften over the coming weeks. Cereal prices may also soften if destocking sales are undertaken in order to accommodate procurement of the bumper Rabi crop. On the other hand, the staggered revisions of milk prices may have a more lasting influence on headline inflation. Prices of pulses are firm, but they might remain range-bound on proactive supply management measures by the government. Overall, the greatly improved prospects of Rabi harvest augur well for food prices in the summer of 2020. One of cost push increases in respect of mobile telephone charges and prices of essential medicines are likely to push up CPI inflation excluding food and fuel, and possible spillovers will need careful monitoring. The projections indicate that inflation pressures could ebb in the second half of 2021 and ease below the target in Q4 of next financial year. Meanwhile, downside risks to global growth have increased in the context of the outbreak of the coronavirus, the full effects of which are still uncertain and unfolding. A well-executed contingency plan may, however, minimize the negative impact of this headwind. Barring the intensification of global risks, I would like to emphasize that there is policy space available for future action. This space needs to be used appropriately and should be suitably timed to optimize its impact on growth. Although monetary policy action is constrained at this juncture by inflation outlook, these pressures should ease going forward. In such a situation, the RBI has several other instruments to address the challenges to growth by improving monetary transmission, as well as by incentivizing the flow of bank credit to productive sectors of the economy. The policy initiatives announced under development and regulatory measures address these objectives, thereby amplifying the intent of monetary policy to support growth while ensuring that inflation remains within the target. Needless to add that the aspect of financial stability is always kept in mind while designing any new regulatory measure. Thus, the development and regulatory policy measures which we are announcing today, they seek to facilitate credit flow to certain sectors, reinforce monetary transmission, strengthen regulation and supervision, broaden and deepen financial markets, and improve the payment and settlement systems. As announced in Statement on Development and Regulatory Policies of January 6, 2019, an internal working group was set up to review the liquidity management framework. Based on the feedback received on draft report from stakeholders and members of the public, the framework is being revised. The framework is simplified by doing away with targeted provisions linked to NDTL. Multiple operations for multiple tenors would be replaced by one fortnightly operation at the beginning of the reporting fortnight, followed by fine-tuning operations every day as required. Liquidity operations shall ensure adequate provision of liquidity to the banking system. The corridor system remains unchanged, and the call money rate continues to be the operating target of liquidity operations. Finally, the revised framework introduces longer-term liquidity management instruments to manage durable liquidity. The details of this framework are spelled out in the Part B of our statement, which is already uploaded in the website. The next announcement is with regard to long-term repo operations, which we propose to undertake. Now, since June 2019, the RBI has ensured that comfortable liquidity is available in the system to facilitate transmission of monetary policy actions. With a view to assuring banks about the availability of durable liquidity at reasonable cost relative to prevailing market conditions, and to further encourage banks to undertake maturity transformation smoothly and seamlessly so as to augment credit flows to productive sectors, the Reserve Bank shall conduct term repo of 1 year and 3 year tenors in appropriate sizes for up to a total amount of rupees 1 lakh crore. From the fortnight beginning 15th February 2020, and it will be done at the policy rate. The next announcement is with regard to incentivizing the bank credit to specific the flow of blank bank credit to specific productive sectors. Alongside sustained efforts to improve monetary transmission, the Reserve Bank is actively engaged in revitalizing the flow of bank credit to productive sectors, having multiplier effects to support impulses of growth. Accordingly, scheduled commercial banks will be allowed to deduct the equivalent of incremental credit disbursed by them as retail loans for automobiles, residential housing, and loans to MSMEs over and above the outstanding level of credit to these segments as at the end of fortnight ending January 31, 2020. So the incremental credit between January 31st, incremental credit over the NDTL of, over January 31st, that will be allowed up to July 31st. Whatever is the incremental credit between January 31st and July 31st, that much will not be taken into account as a part of the NDTL to calculate their CRR requirement. The exemption will be available, as I stated, for incremental credit extended by the banks up to the fortnight ending July 31st. The next decision relates to external benchmarking of new floating rate loans by banks to medium enterprises. Drawing upon the experience of linking all new floating rate personal or retail loans and floating rate loans to micro and small enterprises to external benchmarks, the pricing of loans by scheduled commercial banks for medium enterprises is also being linked to an external benchmark effective from 1st April 2020. We have also proposed to extend the one-time restructuring scheme for MSME advances. In order to create an enabling environment for micro, small, and medium enterprises, that is MSME sector, in its efforts towards increased formalization and to facilitate them to tide over this transition, the Reserve Bank has decided to extend the benefit of one-time restructuring without an asset classification downgrade to GST-registered MSME accounts that were in default but standard as on January 1st, 2020. The restructuring under the scheme has to be implemented latest by December 31st, 2020. Incidentally, the theme of this year's Financial Literacy Week has been selected as MSME enterprise, that is micro, small, and medium enterprises, which will be observed from 10th of February to 14th of February. Now, the earlier scheme which we had introduced on 1st of January, that talked of assets which were, which continued to be standard but were in default. So those loans which could not be restructured under the previous scheme are also eligible for consideration, are also eligible for restructuring in the scheme now, which we are now announcing, and then the next announcement I would like to make is with regard to guidelines on projects under implementation in the commercial real estate sector. Complementing the initiatives taken by the Government of India in the real estate sector, the Reserve Bank has decided to permit extension of the date of commencement of commercial operations of project loans for commercial real estate, delayed for reasons beyond the control of promoters, by another 1 year. Currently, it is 1 year, so we are giving one more year, and this will be given without downgrading the asset classification in line with the treatment which is currently accorded to other project loans for non-infrastructure sector. With regard to regional rural banks, we have decided to permit to undertake certain merchant acquiring businesses to give a fillip to digital banking and to enable the RRBs to provide cost-effective and user-friendly solutions to their customers. Regional rural banks are being allowed, like other commercial banks, to act as merchant acquiring banks using Aadhaar Pay, that is Veeam app and POS POS terminals. With regard to financial markets, transparency of the rupee interest rate derivative market is sought to be enhanced by proposing that all rupee all rupee interest rate derivative transactions of market makers and their related entities globally shall be accounted for in India. This measure would, in addition, encourage non-resident participation, enhance the role of domestic market makers in the offshore market, and strengthen regulatory oversight. The introduction of legislation for netting of financial transactions proposed in the Union Budget 2021 would be a significant enabler for efficient margining. A proper margining system would enhance credibility of the market mechanism and discourage excessive risk-taking. Accordingly, directions are being issued regarding exchange of variation margin for non-centrally cleared derivatives by end March 2020. With regard to payment and settlement systems, I would like to mention that measures in the payment and settlement space, which we now propose to undertake, they include, one, construction and dissemination of a composite digital payments index, DPI, to capture the extent of digitization of payments. So the RBI will develop a kind of index to measure the improvement that digital payments are achieving. Two, a framework for a self-regulatory organization for orderly operations of the entities in the digital payment system will also be put in place. And three, expanding the reach of check truncation system, that also will be now, it will be expanded on a pan-India basis. So with this, I will stop, and we will now entertain questions, which, as I said, my colleagues and I will be happy to answer.
Sir,
thank you.
Sir, aapne kaha ki policy action ke liye...
I'll just...
Okay. Sir Gordon from the Economic Times. Unlike last time, there is no surprise on the interstate side. But you have come up with long-term repo operations of 1 lakh crores and you have exempt CRR for some of these things. So if you could explain what is the idea behind the broader theme, is it a kind of interstate cut hidden there?
No, basically it is an effort to ensure better monetary policy transmission because we are giving it at the policy rate. And so 1 lakh crore we want to inject into the banking system that will enable the banks to, you know, reduce their lending rates. You want to supplement something? Yeah.
Sir,
1 minute. I'll just come. I think he was asking. I'll just come back. Yeah.
आपने कहा कि पॉलिसी एक्शन के लिए स्पेस अवेलेबल है और आपका जो फोकस दिख रहा है महंगाई का उससे लगता है कि अगली पॉलिसी तक महंगाई पीक आउट हो जाएगी सीपीआई जो हमारा करंट प्रोजेक्शन है उसके हिसाब से तो क्या ये अगले एक्शन के लिए रेट कट के लिए काफी होगा या आप कोई खास लेवल देख रहे हैं कि सीपीआई को 5.5 के नीचे या 5 के नीचे आना चाहिए तभी आप एक्शन लेंगे
इसी देखिए मॉनेटरी पॉलिसी में आप देखिए अगर लास्ट ईयर का एक्सपीरियंस आप देखेंगे 2019 इट वॉज फुल ऑफ सरप्राइजेस जो अनसीजनल रेन्स विच हैपेंड इन अक्टूबर एंड नवंबर वेर कम्प्लीटली यू नो अनएक्सपेक्टेड एंड उसकी वजह आई हैव सेड दैट द ऑनियन प्राइसेस अलोन अकाउंटेड फॉर समथिंग लाइक 328 बेसिस पॉइंट्स इन फूड इन्फ्लेशन एंड अबाउट 2% अबाउट 200 बेसिस पॉइंट्स इन द ओवरऑल हेडलाइन इन्फ्लेशन दैट वॉज अ बिग सरप्राइज वेजिटेबल प्राइसेस ऑल्सो दैट वॉज सरप्राइजेस एज ऑफ नाउ एज इट लुक्स आई थिंक करेंट जो अभी का जो करेंट क्वार्टर है वी हैव पीक्ड the headline inflation according to our projection iske aage jo hai wo inflation is expected to go down headline 5.4 fir 5.1 and then it goes below 4% 3.2 so once the downward slope starts then we have to see how quickly and how steeply the downward slope you know is actually playing out uske basis par monetary policy committee mpc decision will take decision at that time I cannot say at this point of time ki kis point mein mpc will act because so many other factors also play their role which you know so many other factors which contribute and impact inflation also they have their role
to any rate cut hoga lekin kab hoga ye faisla baki hai
bilkul I have said ki policy space is available So that is very clear that we have policy space, but it will depend on the evolving situation and the MPC as in 2019 will be very, very proactive even in 2020. Yes.
Kitesh from CNBC TV 18. Can you give us some data, date for the inclusion of Indian bonds in global indexes? Any timeline, when will the first security without FPI limits be issued? Any details that you can add on that? as well. Now, the new thing that you have announced is this long-term repos, 1 year and 3 year. Is it only 1 lakh crore or will it be systematic? You will do more, and will that mean that it will replace OMOs to some extent?
I think you can do it.
So the long-term repo operations are not intended to replace the OMO. They are repo. The OMOs are outrights, right? So the idea is to somehow help banks to reduce the cost of funds for on-lending. That's why it's at the repo rate. And it also gives an assurance of durable liquidity in their hands. And that should encourage them, especially when they're seeing that deposit rates are rigid downwards. That's the idea.
Well, I mean, probably you are referring to the statement in the budget speech by the finance minister, but that certain government bonds will have no limit with regard to non-resident participation. Perhaps you are referring to that. Now, but the primary objective of that is to ensure that, you know, it reflects the robustness of the Indian economy now, that we can accept higher foreign investment, mobilize higher foreign capital into to meet our domestic requirement, but that will flow in terms of rupees. It's not a dollar investment. So it basically reflective of the robustness of the Indian economy, and it also, to considerable extent, you know, foreign savings are being mobilized to meet our domestic requirements. So therefore, the pressure on the domestic savings to meet the requirements of the government, to that extent, they also get minimized. And with regard to inclusion in index, that is something which has to be really worked out.
Or anything of the special security?
We are working on that. It's work in progress.
Because if it is substantial, I assume that...
No,
that
it is currently work in progress. Yeah.
Governor, a little confused about, the broader framework of monetary policy. On the one hand, you're saying that you cannot reduce rates right now due to the inflation pressures. You've said they're elevated, highly uncertain, slight hawkish tinge there to the tonality. On the other hand, liquidity is in extreme surplus, continues to be that way. And between December and February, you have introduced the Operation Twist. It's not clear then what is the framework of monetary policy within which you're operating, and what were you trying to achieve through Operation Twist if it wasn't just bringing down rates broadly?
You'd like to answer that question.
So the monetary policy framework is as defined in the RBI Act, which is it has the main objective of price stability, keeping in mind the objective growth. That doesn't change. Liquidity management is the operating procedure of monetary policy, the way it is implemented. That remains the same. It's only been simplified and refined, and new instruments are being brought in. Okay. Did you have...
No, my question was different. That then why, if you're accommodative, yes, but your liquidity is 2 to 3 lakh crore surplus continuing that way. I know T-bill rates have now moved up, but there was a period where they were close to reverse repo. So there is then de facto another cut. Some private borrowers were borrowing it close to reverse repo. And you had Operation Twist wanting to bring down rates at the long end. So if you wanted to bring down rates, you could have just cut the repo rate, right?
No. You see, there are several options available to the, to the Reserve Bank of India. And we use these instruments that you are suggesting one option, but we decided to choose the other option. And in any case, the surplus liquidity, as I have stated earlier, we are keeping it, so I have said it earlier also, to ensure that there is better monetary policy transmission. So that is why we are keeping the rate as, we are keeping it as a surplus, because notwithstanding our 135 basis points, it needs to also, there has to be adequate liquidity. So it's only from June that the system became surplus in liquidity. So what exact,
Operation Twist, for instance, what was it targeted at? Was it targeted at bringing the long end down or pushing up the short end?
No. Operation Twist is, again, an instrument used to ensure better monetary policy transmission. As you know, the corporate bonds, the corporate bonds, they are benchmarked to the lending rates in the G-Sec segment. So by Operation Twist, if you are able to soften the yields on government securities at the longer end, let's say at 10-year G-Sec, if you are able to bring it down, then that acts as a benchmark for the corporate loan rates. So the effort was mainly to ensure better policy transmission to the corporate bond market, not so much to manage the yield on government securities. Yield in government securities, you know, it's a kind of a, it comes in the line of transmission, in the middle of transmission.
So then how far will you go to manage the long end of the curve?
That will depend on the evolving situation. We are monitoring as and when it is required, we will take necessary steps.
Governor, I have a question.
Yeah.
You know, the union budget had a number of steps. I'm Maithili from ET now. Union budget had a number of steps to incentivize forex flow into the country, whether it is sovereign wealth funds investing in infrastructure area, or also in terms of, you know, the specified government securities without limit. At a time when we've got huge forex inflows, huge, whether by FPI, ECBs, etc., is this the right time to incentivize further flows? Because it creates huge problems for the RBI in terms of managing liquidity, in terms of rupee appreciation, and there's always the danger of this flowing over into higher inflation pressure. That is one. My second question is that you've adopted a slightly convoluted route, I thought, to incentivizing credit flows to certain sectors. You know, incremental credit over 31st March up to 31st July. Why not lower the risk weight? And I invite your attention to Mark Carney's interview to Financial Times, where he said that if you want to increase credit flow, apart from monetary policy, this must be supplemented by easing capital requirements of banks. And this comes from a former governor of the Bank of England. So is the RBI kind of thinking a little bit about being a little bit more relaxed about capital adequacy if you really want to incentivize? Why not lower risk weights for these sectors?
No, as I said in my statement, you know, the underlying theme of all our decisions is financial stability. So therefore, before touching certain macroprudential regulations with regard to capital and risk weight, etc., we have to be very, very careful. I would, I think, request Deputy Governor Vishwanathan to reply.
There are various views on this. I can also refer you to very interesting IMF working papers which say that use of risk weights is not the right tool to incentivize credit flow. So there isn't one single view on this. So we believe that prudence is one part, and prudence, you should not lower prudence. Whatever you do should be with, as governance, financial stability as the underpinning, and that's where we have. We thought this is the way to do it.
Why only 6 months?
Sorry,
not for a longer the facility of lower CRR for incremental housing, car, and
No, it's a balanced call we have taken. It's a balanced call we have taken at this point of time. No, it's too early. No, I think we have just announced it today. The circular will be issued. So too early to say whether we will give an extension. So at this point, if there was such a thing, we would have straight away announced it.
What about forex flows? We didn't answer my question about forex flows. Are you okay with encouraging it even more? Short-term, hot money.
You see, again, no, hot money is your definition. I am not saying so. And usually the bonds, government bonds that will be selected, if they are longer tenure bonds, then they are certainly the money which will come in. They are not hot money. They will come in for 10 years. And 10 years or 5 years or whatever, or a longer tenor, whatever is selected. So therefore, at this point of time, we are, as I again mentioned, that it is a balanced and a calibrated call that we have taken. With regard to forex inflows, we are regularly, it's very carefully and intensely monitored in the Reserve Bank of India. And it again reflects the strength and the rising robustness and the strength of the Indian economy, that today we can absorb so much. And our reserves have touched already 71.6 billion, which I announced today. So we'll be able to deal with the inflows. And there are various instruments available to the Reserve Bank if a situation warrants at any time to intervene. Yeah, Anupji, I'll just...
Governor, sir, I need a clarification on this three-year repo that you mentioned, and you said that it will improve transmission. Now, what happens if a bank borrows now at 5.15% and 1 year down the line you increase interest rate? The banks will be obliged to pass on the rate that time because they have locked in three-year money with you? That is one clarification that I need, how that transmission works. Another is that under the FRBM Act, once the trigger clause is exercised, the government can also monetize their deficit with RBI. So is that a concern for you?
No, at the moment there is no such plan. Let me be very clear. Yeah. At the moment there is no such plan of monetizing the government deficit. The borrowing numbers also are there before you. And I think the increase in the borrowing in the next financial year, in fact, in the current financial year, despite the fiscal deficit going up to 3.8%, the borrowing number, open market borrowing number, remains the same. And next year, the increase is only by 70,000 basis points. And if you, I think, calculate it as a percentage of GDP, it compares very well. I think it's a little lower than the current year borrowing. With regard to the other point which you mentioned, I would request the DG to reply.
Part, sir.
See, as this is basically liquidity management thing that we're getting into. It's a possible thing that you're saying, that how the banks will, it's a call the banks will have to take as to what they say is the three-year interest rate scenario. That's a possibility. But currently what we are looking at is that the banks, if they're just borrowing overnight, it comes back to us overnight into the reverse repo. So we want them to borrow for a longer term, which will actually again move in the form of lending. So we want banks to be able to lend rather than come back to us in the form of a reverse repo overnight.
I think Dr. Park, just one moment. I think you wanted to supplement. Yeah.
It's mentioned in the policy that these 3-year repos will be given at the policy rate today, 5.15. So repo locks that in. If we change the policy rate and we undertake repos at that time, it will be at different rates. But this is locked in at 5.15.
How does it, that transmission happens?
So you get funds at 5.15. Whereas the average cost of funds, taking into account deposits and wholesale, is much higher than that.
Can the banks return the money? I mean, they are locked in for 3 years. What if you interest?
They will return the money after 3 years at 5.15.
No, we will, offer this, and the banks will only take that much which they require. It's not a compulsory thing. It's an option we are giving to the banks. And so it is for the banks to take it, and I'm sure the banks will assess their requirement. Yes, please.
Governor, you made funds cheaper for lending to retail and housing and auto. But at the same time, these segments are linked to the repo rate. So how do you expect the rates to be passed on? Is it through a revision of the spread? And also, wouldn't the deposit insurance increase make the cost of funds higher for banks?
No, deposit insurance, it has, I think, Ms. Dr. Khan, you would like to address that deposit insurance?
Deposit insurance, as you know, the limit has been, the budget announcement was made. And
switch up, please. And it has been, the deposit insurance cover has been increased from 1 lakh rupees to 5 lakh rupees. The premium is something which we are considering. I mean, it has been, it will be increased from 10 paisa to 12 paisa per 100 rupees for the time being. So the impact on the bank's balance sheet is not likely to be much. So that is, as regards the DICGC part is concerned.
No, when they get cheaper funds, it will quicken the process of transmission.
Manojit from the Hindu, I have two questions. One is that the fiscal deficit of 3.8% of the current financial year, was that been factored in by RBI, discounted? What is your view of this fiscal slippage, number one? Number two is that the response to the RBI's specialized supervisory cadre was not very good. There was a very poor response. So why do you think there was, the response was not so good?
No, on the second question, it's a purely an internal administrative matter relating to our personnel. It's an in-house issue. We will resolve it in-house. So I don't want to, talk about it in the media. And it will be resolved. With regard to the first point you said, with regard to fiscal deficit, yes, if you see the MPC resolution, there is a reference to the fiscal deficit, and what RBI is concerned mostly as the debt manager to the government, the RBI is concerned about the borrowing numbers. What are the borrowing numbers? And on borrowing numbers, I have said that next year's borrowing increases by 70,000 crores. I think, if I remember correctly, as a percentage of GDP, it is little lower than what we have in the current year. And secondly, part of the borrowing also, you have, government has also announced that there'll be no restriction on the, there'll be no limit with regard to non-resident investment in certain GSEC, in certain government securities. So therefore, we do hope that it will go through in a non-disruptive manner. Yes.
Ankur Mishra from Financial Express. First question is that you have mentioned in your statement that outlook for inflation remains uncertain at least twice. So how should one read that, considering the fact you have already explained that if the inflation remains within the target which you have mentioned, should we expect the action, cut from the RBI later? And other question is that if you have already you have already mentioned that there is ample liquidity in the system, however the action on CRR has been there. So, why the action has been taken if ample liquidity is there? And third, sir, if you can answer, you have mentioned that 55 basis point decline in MCLR. However, how much do you see that banks can still pass on, considering the fact that in the last policy, there was no action from RBI side, but banks did cut some MCLR.
What is the first question?
There's ample liquidity, why are we doing it?
No, the first question was what?
The first question was that, sir, you have already mentioned in the policy statement at least twice that
I didn't count how many times we mentioned the word uncertainty. But yes, it is definitely, the inflation, the way it has played out last year. It was full of surprises last year, especially with regard to food inflation. And I said it earlier, the MPC will closely monitor the situation and the MPC will act in a proactive manner. When and how? That will depend on the, the evolving situation. So I cannot spell out at this point. There is space for action. RBI, the MPC will act in time and perhaps act ahead of time as it has done in 2019. Yeah.
You didn't answer on
the... Teen question aapne pooch liya na, so... We'll answer the other questions, I think, separately. Let us give chance to others also. Yes.
Governor, on the borrowing program in the budget, the government has actually converting a very sharp, highly sharp amount of 2.7 trillion from short bonds to long bonds in the budget. Does that mean that the RBI will be supporting the government borrowing program through the Operation Twist that you've launched in the past 2 months?
No, Operation Twist, the objective I have clearly explained. It's basically to facilitate monetary transmission to the corporate bond segment, not really to sort of do yield management for the government or supporting the government borrowing program. But as the debt manager of the government, the RBI always will have to ensure that the government borrowing program goes through in a very non-disruptive manner.
Sir, Panika from Money Control. Sir, a little bit more on the CRR exemption. Was this a demand from the banks because they've not been complaining about liquidity actually? Also, a little bit on, is this for only disbursements between this period or, this could be pre-sanctioned loans but disbursements happen in this time? And also, would there be any limits within the segments, within these said retail segments?
The circular is being issued. All these details will be spelled out in the circular.
Okay, sir. The next question on your views on basically the powers for RBI in terms of supervision of cooperative banks, they've been increased. So I want to understand if you think these are good enough to address the earlier concerns of dual control,
Where is DG Jain? I think you can take this question.
I think it's a positive move and definitely it will strengthen our hands and the powers to supervise and regulate these UCBs in a more effective way.
Yes, please.
Sir, Anurag from Z Business, sir. Sir, jis tarah se ye teen sector ko apne riayat di hai CRR ke lekar, to uske piche maksad yehi hai ki jo grahak hai unko aur rahat mile kyunki jo external benchmarking ke jariye linkage hua hai wahan par bhi itna logo ko fayda nahi hua jitna hona chahiye tha. सर दूसरा सवाल मेरा होगा सर कारवी मामले में सेबी के द्वारा कहा गया है कि बैंकों की गलती है और वो मामला आरबीआई को भेजा गया तो उसमें कोई निर्णय लिया गया है और सर ये करेंसी ट्रेडिंग का समय बढ़ाने के आप पक्ष में है क्या क्योंकि अब एनईएफटी तो 24 आवर्स खुला है
तीन क्वेश्चंस आपने पूछे
सर कभी कभी मौका मिलता है
फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन तो आई हैव फॉरगॉटन बट करेंसी यस ऑफ फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन वॉज लास्ट क्वेश्चन वॉज विद रिगार्ड टू करेंसी ट्रेडिंग आवर्स एट द मोमेंट वी हैव नो सच As and when we take a decision, it will be announced. I don't want to give any sort of indication as to, but it is, we will see. We have not decided anything on that. कारवी के बारे में वो आई मीन दैट इज इंटरनली अंडर कंसिडरेशन अंडर एग्जामिनेशन जो डिसीजन लिया जाएगा वी विल यू नो आई कैनॉट जस्ट बिफोर एनी डिसीजन हैज बीन टेकन मे आई कैनॉट इंडिकेट यू नो व्हाट विल बी डन एंड फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन वॉज
सर ये जो तीन सेक्टर के लोन है जहां पर
वो तो पहले रिप्लाई कर दिया था ना आपने
नहीं नहीं सर उसमें आप एक्सटर्नल
द कॉस्ट ऑफ फंड्स जो है वो बैंकों के लिए वो कॉस्ट ऑफ फंड्स नेचुरली यू नो विल इट विल हैव एन इफेक्ट
ऑन द सर आप मानते हैं कि एक्सटर्नल बेंचमार्किंग का जितना ग्राहकों को फायदा होना चाहिए था उतना नहीं हुआ और बैंकों को और फायदा देना चाहिए
नहीं जैसे मैंने कहा लास्ट एमपीसी में मैंने कहा था कि लास्ट एमपीसी प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस में मैंने कहा था कि 49 बेसिस पॉइंट्स का ट्रांसमिशन हुआ है आज मैंने कहा कि 69 बेसिस पॉइंट्स का ट्रांसमिशन हुआ है नए लोन के ऊपर सो इट इज इम्प्रूविंग एंड इट विल इम्प्रूव और हम जो मेजर्स ले रहे हैं आज इट विल फर्दर एक्सिलरेट दैट प्रोसेस यस आई थिंक टू और थ्री मोर आई विल कम बैक एंड वी विल कंक्लूड या
सो द रूपी आईआरडी अनाउंसमेंट दैट हैज बीन डन टुडे आर यू टारगेटिंग पीपल हु आर ट्रेडिंग इन द एनडीएफ मार्केट हु आर रेगुलेटेड एंटिटीज विद यू डिस्क्लोजिंग देयर पोजीशंस नाउ बिकॉज़ दे विल बी ट्रांजैक्टिंग देयर Also, it's a very basic question. What is your currency strategy at this point of time? What is the currency strategy at this point of time? Because we are bulking up. 2 years ago, we were in the US list. At this point of time, we are talking about sovereign bond indices. So the link between policy rates and FX is increasing. We have done FX swaps also. So these links are all coming together. So what is the RBI's current currency strategy? And
इसी करेंसी स्ट्रेटेजी जो है वो तो यू नो इट हैज इट्स एन इंटरनल ऑपरेटिंग प्रोसीजर एंड इट हैज गॉट यू नो एनीथिंग दैट आई से विल बी मार्केट सेंसिटिव सो आई डोंट वांट टू से एनीथिंग विथ रिगार्ड टू एनडीएफ आई थिंक ईडी रविशंकर कैन रिप्लाई
Yeah, the idea is not to interfere with what is happening in the NDF market, but currently the market is extremely opaque to us. It's an important policy variable, the interest rate. So we want to improve the transparency of that market. That is the basic, you know, basic driving thinking behind this move.
But we expect them to actually report their transactions. That, as in they, these are people who have chosen not to disclose in the past also when they were involved in these
We will work out the details, but currently what the announcement is not that the transactions will be reported, but the transactions will be in the books of the Indian entity.
Yeah, please.
So, Gopika from Mint. You have announced the extension of DCC of project loans to commercial real estate sector. Is there has RBI quantified the amount of loans given to, or which will be extended under the scheme? Also, you've said that delayed for reasons beyond the control of promoters. Who will decide that? Because most of the major reason or the one of the problems in the sector is that there's been siphoning of funds and so on. So who decides the delay of...
No, even the current regulations with regard to infrastructure projects, with regard to non-infrastructure projects, there are also, you know, these 1 year or 3 years is given with regard to reasons beyond their control. And it is very well spelled out. So a similar thing will be operational here. You would like to...
Exactly what the government said.
Could you quantify? Has
no, quantification we have not done. But even now, this is not something new we are saying. This is already well defined in the case of infrastructure loans, and in the case of other loans, it is already there. Even in this case, it is currently 1 year, so it's not a new formulation.
It's that's where the glut is. That's where the problem is. There's not much of a problem in commercial real estate.
Sorry.
Only restricting it to commercial real estate.
Like this, for residential,
why not to residential real estate? Because question, there is a problem.
No, you see, a counter question can be asked. Like, for example, retail loans for housing sector we are doing. We are not doing any real, you know, any measures for the commercial estate sector. In commercial estate sector, there are many incomplete projects. So it's basically to deal with those incomplete projects, which got delayed for reasons beyond their control because of some environment clearance getting delayed or some court stay or some other kind of, impediment which came in their way. And it is very well spelled out. Yes, please. I think two more questions.
Small clarification.
I'll just come. She's been waiting for a long time.
Yes, Swati from Reuters. Governor, I just wanted to understand, with regards to the NDF markets, I mean, we've maintained that we don't actually intervene there. But if you look at the RBI bulletin, There are 5 months in the last 1 year where in the intervention part of it, we've mentioned onshore and offshore markets. And it is not a template change because that's not there in every bulletin. What is the reason for us mentioning onshore and offshore in those intervention, like 5 times in the last 1 year? Where exactly were we intervening when we say offshore? Just wanted that clarification.
You would like to deal with that? I don't know. I mean, which officer reports he's talking about? We'll check up. I'm not able to exactly get the...
This is in the section where we give the dollar buy sale. So in the bulletin, just 5 times in the last 1 year, it's been a small part, but we've mentioned intervention in onshore and offshore in brackets, whereas usually it's just onshore rupee markets. So why was that offshore word included there, and are we actually intervening in
I'll have to check up which report you are referring to. I'll have to check up and provide that clarification separately. Yeah.
Small clarification. Sir, LTRO will be government bonds only, right? Only government, LTRO
we accept no collateral.
Yeah. Governor, one small clarification. You know, the MPC has accepted this 5% GDP growth for this year, whereas after the revised estimates, actually because of the lowering of the base, it gets bumped up to 5.7%. Was this taken on account by the MPC, and did you know, opt for 5% thinking that actually it will be less, that even with the bump up, then we will finally only get to 5?
I think it's clear that question.
You know, when the first advance estimates are put out by the National Statistics Office, they don't put out a level. They put out a weighted average growth rate. So they take the indicators, their growth rates, and they average it and give a growth rate. So the 5% doesn't change.
So the revised estimates, if you take the revised estimates, because the lower one, you know, last year's goes on from 6.8. The base has changed. 6.8 goes to 6.1.
It's just a growth rate applied to any base, you'll get 5%.
You see, that will not alter the 5%. We have checked on that point. Yes. I think PMC Bank, the administrator and the advisory committee, they have now greater clarity with regard to the various, financial position of the bank, and they are working out the next course of action. Yes, I think, yeah.
So of hike in deposit insurance be available to banks which are currently under administration and could possibly go into liquidation actually?
Yes. Yes, isn't it? It will apply. You can just clarify.
No, actually, as per the DICC Act, the insurance premium is paid only when the bank goes into liquidation. But we also have a scheme under which the restructuring also DICC aids that. So there are different schemes.
Okay, then. So I think we'll conclude. Thank you very much. And if there are other questions which you have, I mean, there will be occasion to meet again, and we can meet separately also. I will deal with it, after this is over. But thank you very much for your patience. Yeah.